as well. So next up is Maria.
Wow.
Everybody give Maria a warm welcome.
Oh, thanks everybody. Yeah, well, welcome back after that short break. Following that very technical discussion that we've had prior to my talk, I would like to give you a bit more of a business use case perspective. Especially from the viewpoint of a service manager who is the interface to the customer, to the end user, the customer. And I concentrate on how Cloud Stack as our tool is supporting me in these key performance indicators. Now, a little bit more about myself. I'm Maria Barta. I work for iTelligence as a service manager since 2017. And prior to that, if anyone had ever told me that I would be working for an IT company, I would have laughed, because as my final point on that note kind of states quite clearly, I have no prior IT knowledge. Please remember that when we come to the final slide that says questions. So if there's any technical-based questions, come and speak to me at the next coffee break, and I'm sure I'll note down all of your questions and refer it back to my administrative team in order to, you know, give you the right answers there as well. So what is my background? I'm more of a project manager, and within that I have more than 10 years experience with big corporate companies before I joined iTelligence in 2017. I also want to join Giles real quickly in thanking the organizational team that have put this event together, because especially Yvette, I talk from experience. Usually this is my kind of role for our user group events. Giles have mentioned it. We have a user group in Germany as well, a Cloud Stack German user group, and there I try and organize similar events as you have done, and this is a great turnout, so thank you very much. Why is it though that I'm talking to you here today? There's several reasons, but as we are quite heavily involved in open source technology communities, our administrators and architects have already taken part in over seven community events. And I think that my manager's reason really to say, Maria, it's your turn to do a presentation now, is because usually I'm always taking part in the very final agenda point, which is the informal gathering and having a nice drink bit, which is still the point I'm looking forward to the most. As I understand, there will be cocktails today. So yeah, but until we get there, maybe also a few words to iTelligence, as my predecessors have done. Please show your hand if you've ever heard of iTelligence before. Right. Thank you, Giles. yes, well, I don't blame you. Before iTelligence and the Bit Group that I used to work for have merged in 2018, I was not quite aware of how big a player this is within that industry either, but the numbers on this slide kind of show how significant a player it is. So we've got more than 8,000 now employees, and the headcount steadily growing, as well as revenue seems to be growing, and we are present in over 25 countries all around the world. However, essentially it is a German company with its headquarters in Bielefeld, which also would explain, of course, the revenue distribution mostly in German-speaking European countries. Right. iTelligence in its core is an SAP service provider. So what they do is they outsource different functions like consulting, support, development of their SAP products to our company iTelligence. But our team, or our business unit, Cloud Infrastructure Services, has created an innovation area that kind of tries and sets themselves away a little bit and looks into other avenues and technologies and tries to build future possible products that we might go into and not be so dependent on our SAP partner. And within that infrastructure services business unit, our team, the cloud infrastructure architecture team, that's the team I work and support with on a daily basis. So we, as such, have cloud environment that we build with open source technologies. We pride ourselves in using only open source technologies. Also, a key indicator is automation. We are a very small team, so once we develop a new product, we want to make sure that this product can be used as autonomously as possible by the end user, because we haven't got the structure of a support team with it. So we try to automate as much as possible from the infrastructure side as well as our application side when it comes to SAP products. Since we are the main team within our company that has open source knowledge, we also help train and consult the other teams if there's any interest in such things, and to take advisory services. Now, because of course our main business is with SAP, we do not support productive environments at the moment. We focus on our internal demo testing landscapes and try to be the internal outsourcing option number one for any sort of requirements, like for instance, a consultant goes out to the end user for an SAP product. He wants to just demonstrate them very quickly how it functions. So that demo system would be placed with us, for example. Right, so what technologies do we use within our team? We, of course, use as a cloud management platform for compute storage network, our cloud stack. Automation framework is Ansible. KVM, we've already heard, is obviously a very compatible tool to work together with cloud stack, as well as the other chosen technologies here for our other services that are required in order to fulfill our customer needs. Since I'm here to talk about service managers and my functions and daily challenges, I just wanted to give you a quick overview of what it is that I actually do within my function, and it concentrates on four main areas. One I've already explained is like the innovation stuff. Being part of the innovation team, we of course thrive to look out for new business opportunities, but also product opportunities, going into application installations to automate these, and through feedback from customer experience, we also continuously develop our portal, which is our user interface actually that we set on top of Cloud Stack. Operationally wise, more of a project management role. I look to distribute between the teams and amongst our administrators and architects the different requirements that we get placed within the team, do the time scheduling, look at the controlling and contracting side of things, and also ensure that, of course, if we have certain demands coming in, that we can actually fulfill them, and looking at the capacity management and stuff. Marketing, a big part of my role, because as we said, I think Jas mentioned it as well, Cloud Stack, what is that, never heard of it. We face similar problems with that in the German environment. So we do try and promote the open source technologies that we use actively and regularly by taking part in community events like such, and also having our own meetup groups in Germany themselves. But also internal marketing, more of our own cloud solution, because like I told you, we've just merged with a bigger company. They obviously have got many business units that also have never heard of our cloud solution. So we are still trying to expand our visibility within our own company for them to use us more regularly. And customer support, of course, a key factor of a service manager role, because the end user, in fact, is what we all hope to satisfy through service level agreements, incident management, and regular feedback sessions, right, to evolve further. What are these key points for our customers? Transparency, I think we all know, especially within the cloud business, we feel that most potential customers have a fear of loss of control, especially when it concerns an overview of the cost they incur. So transparency and being able to show to them how much have you used and how much do we charge you for it is very important, which CloudStack therefore provides a good basis with their usage reports. Performance and capacity. With performance, we kind of look at, well, how well are my virtual systems functioning? If there's an error, where exactly can I find it immediately? So there we've also built a tool for our monitoring capabilities. Capacity, again, if I want to build a cloud environment, and we aim to do it on demand without any contractual periods involved in it, well, then they should also be able to get what they are asking for. So visibility on capacity availability is also very important on that. Data security, of course, always we work with client-sheeted networks and secure VPNs. Solutions and focus on distributed storage systems, data protections, again, well, backup solutions and also multi-tenancy arrangements, very important, which again, as you will later see, plays into our choice of tools. The user experience is, of course, very important. Self-service seems to be a big point coming on lately. People or users want to be able to act if and when they want to, build it or demolish it whenever they want to. They don't want to be waiting for long workflow queues or advise you in advance that in 3 weeks' time they need that environment set up. So self-service, we found for our customers, is a crucial point. That needs to be presented in a user-friendly way. So the portal that we have used as our self-service point has also got a very user-friendly surface. Not to say that, of course, the CloudStack surface isn't a user-friendly one, but we have to remember that our end users are not administrative developers. They are literally the end user that are working in the business field environment. So they would not be able to cope with even network situations, right? So it needs to be very high level, very clear and easy to use for them. Same with scalability and service level agreements that underlie these services. So then with that in mind, looking at CloudStack and how does CloudStack help us in fulfilling those requirements? Well, when we first started this project, we looked, of course, at the various options that are available out there, but we found and we still are experiencing that CloudStack works very well for small operational teams because it is stable, simple, and easy to maintain. And now I've mentioned before, we are an innovation team, we are not a productive team, so our capabilities for support or maintenance is very limited. We want to keep developing and be innovative, right? So it needs to also then be with tools that are easy to operate. Upgrade, I've been told, is a great process with CloudStack, right? As compared with other stack products that may or may not take several days in this process. Here, on average, we can, depending on how big the circumstances are, but on average, 30 minutes and an upgrade is done, as it is an all-in-one software and not modular-based, as maybe other solutions are. Saying that, and not really saying it as a negative aspect, but just bearing in mind why I'm here. I'm here to present you my perspectives from a service manager point of view. Yes, it is easy to upgrade, but there is still a lot of work on my side that goes on with that because it has to still be communicated with the end user, with the customers. Downtime scheduling has to be arranged, even if it's only an administrative downtime and not one where the underlying functioning is not working anymore. But still, communication is the key when it comes to service management and customer satisfaction. Also checking that when we do the downtime, does it affect any service level agreements, yes or no, and work with it. To make it a little bit more easy, we set up templates, email templates. I know it sounds very simple, but again, we have not a 24-hour, 7 days a week support system behind us. So if I'm not there to communicate with the customer, I need my administrators who are working on an upgrade or any issues that may occur with it, which obviously don't, but to be able to also communicate back to the customer in that instance. Great active community. I think we all know that this is one of the major points, because especially when it comes to feature request processes, and even when they occur, bugs and issues, it is important if you don't have your own programmers that there is a process in place and that you are able to share with your community thoroughly and regularly. I have a little example for you here. One admin said to me, well, one great example was when the resizing of the Ceph volume was only working offline. It should have also worked online. Right here, a bit of background story. So he, through accident, found out that there was a wrong command somewhere on the hypervisor. Please don't quote me on anything that I say now.
Is this but what you tell your users?
No, of course not. So the point of this whole story was that he was actually just shortly afterwards at one of the collaboration conferences, and through inter-exchanging experiences, spoke to one of the cloud stack developers, who said, "Well, if you already know where the problem is, just not exactly in the coding, understand how to fix it, just place it in the feature in the issue request on." GitHub, I think, and push it through. And within 12 hours, I've been told, it was actually worked upon and resolved. And with the next release, the bug did no longer exist. So that to just show you how important it is to be actively involved and use this great community that CloudStack has. Usage report, I try to explain to you why that is important to me, especially with the transparency of costs occurred. Here, we built our own billing tool to actually pull the data, the historic data that the usage reports from CloudStack provide us and give us a very comprehensive billing report at the end. Multi-tenancy is important, of course, when you're working with separate different customer entities, and it has to work with the other chosen open source technologies. An example here is our Ansible automation tool. Now, and I suppose Giles said it himself, CloudStack provides the essential functions, but it is by no means maybe a full toolkit for every individual scenario or environment that you are actually working for or trying to develop. So for us, we also had one or two things, like for instance, the billing report I was talking about, and also the self-service component that our customers or end users, I should say, are able to just automatically by themselves enter our portal and build up their environments autonomously. So we built this portal that consolidates all of the underlying systems, services, and their individual designs and functions, and have one customer-facing united way of presenting that in a very, very simple and user-friendly format for non-admin people. It has different capabilities, such as user management, server management, storage management. So all of that you can actually do yourself by just pressing a couple of buttons, and the automation will take over, and you will have the desired environment at the end. This is the picture, just showing at one glance the scenario that I was trying to outline to you in the previous page. So we've got the user interface, our portal, that via the daemon speaks to our automation tool. And the second layer in between there is where also our cloud stack, cloud management platform is, which is, of course, still the central orchestrating tool for steering the storage, hypervisor, and network components. Like I said, the portal also integrates all of the other services that lie underneath it that are important to us, like, for instance, the LDAP, which is the authentication tool for user rights, etc. Then the CheckMK for our monitoring purposes, and the billing report, which is still an external and not quite incorporated into our tool yet, but it still feeds in there. The customer experience, I'm just now summarizing what we've gone through again, just to highlight it more visibly. Self-service approach, we've talked about, we enhanced through our portal option. Scalability and flexibility. Again, here, I think what we try to, how do I put that? It's, again, not a negative, because bugs do exist and they will exist, I'm sure, but it's more of the fact that CloudSec is being used by so many different companies in a very different forms for and applied differently. So not every CloudSec user will come across same issues and problems. For example, I think my admin told me the example was that dedicated public IP ranges, something happened to the dedicated public IP ranges. As part of a merge, this command had not been reactivated, and after the merge request, this function did not work anymore. Now, if of course this is not a high priority within one of your other companies that uses CloudSec, they would have not noticed that, but because it is such a focused component of our customer, what we provide for our customers, right, it is important. We immediately saw that as a problem. And of course, we registered it again in the issue tracker, and it was fixed and everything. But in the meantime, we needed to find a solution, because of course, if that wasn't in place anymore, there was a risk for fulfilling service level agreements. And even on a billing side, I mean, if you've got a customer that pays for their own dedicated public IP ranges, and now all of a sudden everyone is pulling out of the same pool, well, he would have wanted his money back, or at least an explanation for it. So we needed to find a workaround. Meanwhile, while this bug or error or issue was worked upon, and that, for us with a small team, is very time-consuming, because again, we haven't got cloud stack developers, we've got admins, so it takes them even longer to go through all of the different merge requests and find the actual command that is affected here. So yes, it is a time-intensive process that goes on in the background, but nevertheless, I do want to stress that the issue was placed and it was resolved within the next merge request again. And of course, admittedly, we were not able to use our test environment, which we usually use before we put it in upgrades into productive environments. That also doesn't happen anymore. Plus, I was told now that we follow the Shapeloot upgrade path, that shouldn't happen in any case anymore. Right, transparency again, just to summarize it, the invoicing through the billing tool. Alex was just at the conference in Brazil that you've mentioned, and he'd explained obviously the underlying technology. You won't hear that from me today, but instead I'll show you what I see when I open the report. I can filter on you know, the start or end date of the run of the VM, the domains, the different projects. So it's very clear for me to show to the end user what they've used when for which machine, and I can then export it in the format that I want to. quota here. We used our initial screen in our own portal that I've mentioned earlier. And for that, each customer in their own domain is able to set their own quota initially so that they can see when they first enter the tool, okay, from the 20 virtual machines that I have got available, 3 are running, maybe 1 is not running. You can then go into the in-depth level of that machine and find out why it is not running. Also, but more importantly, I think, is also the items that incur costs on them, which is the usage of CPU and RAM. So they've got that all at one glance and are always informed about their actual current status. Current status of their machines is also important when looking at monitoring. And again, we've incorporated that into our user management portal. And again, they can see from the infrastructure to the VM what is the actual current status of their systems at the time. Now, the final point that I work on regularly is the publicity factor, because we have challenges when hiring new staff with the required experience and knowledge for CloudStack or other open source technologies and such, and also within our own company, the competitive situation, right? If we think of new strategic ways to expand in the future, we obviously look at what technologies do we want to use, and when we suggest CloudStack, there always is a bit of a feeling of, well, you know, caution, as people just don't know about it enough. So that is our aim through our involvement in the various communities or the trainings and consulting functions that we do and provide within our team to increase that awareness of those open source technologies, especially our CloudStack in this instance. And with that, I'm now looking forward to the very final point of the agenda, because I have finished my presentation. I hope I could give you a little bit of an insight of, you know, the background, you know, the end user perspective of these technology, great technologies that you're all developing and working on. And yeah, keep doing a great job and be active in the community to improve it even further. Thank you very much. Those are my favorite. Well, if you do have anything you want to talk to me about, I'm happy to exchange cards with you at the coffee break or even later at the cocktail part. So yes, feel free, come and talk to me. I'm happy to speak to you.
It's very brave to talk to Robbins.
Thank you very much. Thank you.